Australian Post Office archives contain many historical documents, and none is more interesting than the story of the Overland Telegraph Line. Built in 1872, across almost unknown country, the line was the dream of Sir Charles Todd, then Postmaster General of South Australia. Its building is a story of sacrifice, privations, and great determination.
The route of the line is to follow that traverse by John McDowell Stewart, with the northern terminus at Darwin. As little information of the country to be passed through is known, I have arranged to fit out and dispatch an exploring party in advance of the construction gangs. The line will be constructed in three main sections. The first section will be from Port Augusta to latitude 27 degrees. The second section, through difficult and waterless country, will go to about 20 degrees. The third section, from latitude 20 degrees northward, 600 miles to Darwin. About every 150 miles, we will establish repeater stations. Each will need to be provided with adequate protection against the aboriginals and to be reasonably close to any natural water we may find.
Our journey along the Overland Telegraph Line begins at Alice Springs. Originally called Stewart, after the intrepid explorer John McDowell Stewart, Alice Springs is now a thriving township, set like a jewel 2,000 feet above sea level among the colorful, glowing peaks of the McDonnell Ranges. Gateway to the inland, Heavy Tree Gap, so named after Charles Heavytree Todd, is one of the several gorges in the McDonnell Ranges. Through it runs the Overland Telegraph Line, the North-South Road, the railway line from Adelaide to Alice Springs, and the Todd River. A bed of sand in the dry season, the Todd, fringed with ghost gums, becomes a swirling torrent during the wet. 2 miles north of Alice Springs stands the old telegraph station, on the site of the original township of Stewart. Today, it is an Aboriginal reserve. The old buildings still remain after 80 years. Lovingly, one of the pioneers of the station described to us the scene as he remembered it nearly 50 years ago. In a well-kept graveyard nearby lie the men who died in the telegraph service. Surely, it is fitting that the names of these pioneers live on in post office history. From Alice Springs, camel trains once carried the mail to outback stations. Now, light aircraft cover more than 500,000 square miles of territory. West to Wyndham, east to the Gulf of Carpentaria, they wing their way over 8,000 miles of air route carrying the mails and freight. The link between isolation and the cities. These planes are also the basis of the Flying Doctor Service, providing transport whenever the voice of mercy calls. Radio, thanks to the vision of the Reverend John Flynn, has overcome the loneliness of the outback. Near the Flying Doctor base is a model iron wire known as the OT line. From Alice Springs, surface mail from the south goes once weekly by road along the Stewart Highway almost 1,000 miles to Burdham, the terminus of the railway from Darwin. Following the bitumen strip linking Australia's red heart with the tropical north, this is the longest and fastest road mail service in Australia. The bitumen road has opened the heart of the continent to the tourist, and luxurious coaches now ply regularly along the route. Before us lies the real Australia, primitive yet glorious in its heritage of sunshine and colour. To the east and to the west lie the trackless wastes of the centre, with only an occasional post office, hotel or store marking man's progress in this vast and silent land. Soon we approach the geographical centre of the continent. It was on this site in 1872 that Sir Charles Todd made the final link in the telegraph line joining the colony with the motherland.
When the wires were joined, I was at Central Mount Stuart, and in the evening was inundated with kindly worded messages of congratulations from friends in all parts of the colonies. It was a bitterly cold night, as, seated on the ground with only a pocket relay held in my hand, I received one after another of these friendly recognitions from those who took an active interest in my work and welfare.
At Barrow Creek, the original telegraph repeater station built in 1872 is still in use. These repeater stations were like forts, with high stone walls for protection. This was the scene in 1874 of the Barrow Creek Massacre, famous in the history of the OT line. Coming down the red hill behind the station, dragging spears between their toes to conceal their intentions, the blacks attacked the telegraph station without warning. Today, beside the Stuart Highway, sheltered by a tree, are the graves of the men who lost their lives in the fight that followed, keeping open the slender iron thread joining Darwin and Adelaide. North from Barrow Creek, through the Devonport Ranges, we follow the line, passing through a natural rock formation known as the Devil's Marbles. Huge, rounded masses of granite, perched one on another, spread for miles. Tradition has it that these rocks are sacred to the Aboriginals, and even today, no woman of their race will go through them. Until 1920, Terence Creek was a remote overland telegraph station. Now it is the third largest town in the Northern Territory, and for miles around, poppet heads dot the red earth where men dig in the quest for gold. Here, as everywhere else where gold is won, are stories of reefs rich beyond the dreams of men. Someday, Terence Creek may be another Kalgoorlie with its golden mile. As we continue northwards towards Daly Waters, we pass a natural rock formation known as Churchill's Head, which dominates the country for many miles. The addition of the cigar, however, is credited to troops moving through the area during World War II.
Waldemar Holtz, appointed telegraph messenger, Darwin, 1881.
Known throughout the territory to whites and Aboriginals alike as Wallaby, Mr. Holtz now lives at Powell Creek. For more than 60 years, he's worked in the Northern Territory and seen the homesteads come along the route of the Iron Ribbon across the continent. As Mr. Holtz records for historical purposes some of his reminiscences of the early days, we hear of dramatic stories of the far outback, stories rich in adventure and achievement in the history of his beloved OT line. Years ago, Mr. Holtz was postmaster at Daly Waters, and his nearest neighbors were 100 miles away. Little now remains of the buildings which he and his staff occupied. White ants have almost completely destroyed the original telegraph station, although, until 1950, it was still in use as a post office. Now a new post office has been built. Daly Waters, set in a wilderness of spinifex and mulga bush, is an important weather station and air junction. Here on a modern aerodrome, the giant planes of Trans-Australia Airlines pause in their flight across a continent. Air transport is opening up Australia's distant places, and today there are few parts of the continent which cannot be reached by the National Service or feeder lines. ¶¶ Northern Territory is cattle country. To feed the men of the OT line, the post office has maintained its own cattle stations, and one of the biggest of these was at Bailey Waters, where on an area of 500 square miles, cattle roamed bearing the brand of the Broad Arrow over the letters TD. But the coming of the bitumen and the regular road freighters plying along the route between Alice Springs and Darwin means that the post office no longer has to feed its own. So, the cattle have been sold. Maintenance men of the OT line were originally appointed for their ability to maintain themselves under hazardous conditions. Through country arid in the dry season and often flooded in the wet, their work still involves great hardships. Their horses may sink to their girths in mud, for this is still a land of contrasts. At Daly Waters, we are still on the route followed by John McDowell Stewart, as we are reminded by this tree, which stands not far from the Daly Waters post office. Soon on our journey northwards, we pass Warlock Ponds and come to the peaceful beauty of the Elsie Memorial Cemetery. Here we pause a moment to find for ourselves the graves of the real-life characters from the book We of the Never Never. Here they sleep, the Maluka, the Fizzer, the Headstockman, the Sanguine Scott, and the others from Mrs. Aeneas Gunn's well-loved story. A feature of the road we are following is the sheer beauty of the flowers, and few of the roadside hotels are without their garland of bougainvillea. About Catherine, the country begins to change, becomes more densely wooded, and gradually the climate grows hotter. Now we are on the edge of the tropics. Here the rivers have water in them, instead of sand, even in the dry season. Many Aboriginals are employed throughout Australia by the post office, and at Catherine we meet this Bathurst Island boy, immensely proud of Red Bicycle and the work he's doing in the communication service of his country. Once the center of a gold rush with 10,000 inhabitants, Pine Creek today is a ghost town, dozing in the sun among the giant ant hills, which are a feature of North Australia. Though called ant hills, these are really the nests of termites, which make life difficult in most parts of the territory. The hills are riddled with tunnels, and when these are opened, we can see the winged adults, the workers, and the soldiers. To the men of the OT line, the war against these insects is never ending, for the problems of maintenance are acute. Not only are the wooden telegraph poles eaten away, but the termites also eat the lead sheathing on underground and aerial cable. Adelaide River is a center of cattle stations for hundreds of miles around, and a meeting place for stockmen, jackaroos and boundary riders, bronzed by the tropic sun. Near the township, which is on the railway line to Darwin, we stop at the war cemetery. Simply, the story is told by the notice at the entrance. They died that Australia might be free. and amid the green lawns and the white crosses, we remember them. A little distance away are the graves of 10 post office employees killed while on duty at the Darwin Post Office on that morning in February 1942, when Australia first felt the impact of an enemy bomb. Today, the shell of the old post office block still stands, a grim reminder of the closeness of the battle to our cities in the South. Darwin is the gateway to Australia's north, with its wide harbour and lovely bays, with its fine streets fringed with milkwood trees, waving palms and poinciana. It is destined to become a model tropical city. Today, in the dry season, it is a paradise for tourists. It may be midwinter in the south, but here you can swim and bask in the warming sun. And over all is the scent of the tropical flowers, and in the botanical gardens they bloom in all their glory of rich colour. Once weekly from Darwin, south to Burdham, brings the mail which came overland from Alice Springs. Darwin is an important postal centre, and hundreds of bags of mail arrive here each week for distribution to the scattered outposts of the north. Darwin, too, as dawn breaks, go out the great airliners carrying the mail overseas, linking Australia with the world beyond the horizon. And now our journey is complete. Today, the Overland Telegraph Line is a memorial to an engineering feat without parallel in the history of Australia, a glowing tribute to the courage of Sir Charles Todd and his staunch band of men. To post office people everywhere, it is, too, a fitting reminder that theirs is a proud heritage of perseverance, loyalty, and great service.